This program is being presented to you by the Heraeus International Winter School on Gravity and Light.
Hello and welcome back to the WE Heraeus International Winter School on Gravity and Light. Today's topic, integration. Exercise 1, integrals and volumes. First, we will start with a few basic questions to spark discussions, you know. Okay, first, integration on a manifold requires a notion of orientability. This is certainly right, because we defined to, we tried to define the integration of function with respect to a chart, and of course such a definition has to be independent of the chosen chart. So what did you define? You defined the integral over a chart domain U of a function f as the integral over the image of the chart domain on another chart map. Then you made use of a volume form, defined these omegas which depend on the chosen chart and of course on the points where you evaluate. And the f you have to consider also in the chart. So here they enters x inverse of alpha, and it is a d-dimensional integrals and the integration variables we called alpha. So what happens now if you switch to another chart? Why? Well, you know, this is here you can apply the formula for transformations, for the transformation of multidimensional integrals, with your transformation function being the chart transition map x inverse after y. Y is a new chart. So an integral transforms like this. Here you have the new integration domain. Now you consider f at the image y inverse of your new variables beta. And you don't just integrate over d to the d beta, you pick up the absolute value of the determinant of this derivatives of the chart transition map. So determinant del x a, del y b. And these objects you defined, they transform only with the determinant of del y a del x b. This enters here. And you see, only if these two guys cancel each other to one, then the definition of integration of a function in a chart domain is independent of the chosen chart. So this is exactly the notion of orientability we require, that those determinants that appear if you change between charts are always positive. So we can take this option. Second, the integral over some chart domain U of a function f on the manifold is simply defined in the chart Ux, as the integral over the chart is just the integral over the function in the chart integrated over these alphas. And you can readily see that this is not quite true, because we defined it with making use of these objects omega, and you can see why we had to do this, because if you change between two charts you pick up this factor and this factor needs to be cancelled with this factor, you get exactly from this omega. So it is not true. Third, any volume form can be chosen to integrate over an oriented manifold. Well, this is certainly true. These objects omega, you can construct making use of a volume form. Later on, we choose a specific volume form, which you can construct out of the metric G, but any volume form does the trick. Of course, you have to provide this volume form, which is additional information, and if you already have a metric, so a metric manifold, you may just use this information and you don't need to give any further information in order to integrate functions. Fourth, the transformation law for integrals also holds for transition between charts. Right. And why is that? Because the transition between charts is a map. Oh, I made a small mistake here. Test says inverse on this side. And then it's a map from RD into RD, which is smooth and bijection. And it is exactly this kind of maps for which you can apply the transformation law for integrals, for multi-dimensional integrals. So it's true. Last, the component functions of the volume form satisfy this anti-symmetry property. Well, this is of course true, because if you recall what a volume form was, it was just a totally anti-symmetric zero D form on a D-dimensional manifold. That means the volume form, which we call it capital omega, the volume form capital omega gets dim M vectors. And if you interchange any two vectors, you will pick up a minus sign. So for example, it is the same as minus omega of x1 onto xi. Well, so for example, I could interchange x1 and x2, so put first x2 and then x1 into the form. And then I pick up a minus sign. And this holds for any two vectors I interchange. And this carries over to the component functions, because as you recall, they were just defined by inserting basis vectors into the tensor, so like this, and here it says I1, of course. So interchanging basis vectors here leads to a minus sign, and of course it leads to interchange indices here. Question. Calculate the volume of the round sphere S2 of radius r, that is the integral over the whole S2 of the constant function 1. Well, this is not that easy, because one chart does not suffice to cover whole S2, because S2 is not homeomorphic to the real plane R2. Consider, for example, our familiar chart, which is the spherical coordinate chart UX, and take a look at this picture of the sphere. Now, the domain for this chart is given by excluding the north pole, the South Pole, and this meridian so excluding this line from the sphere, and this you map with x into the interval 0 pi cross 0 to pi. So you see you excluded here 1 and pi, which corresponds to North Pole and South Pole, and you excluded here the 0 or the 2 pi, which corresponds to all points lying on this line. Now you could give a different chart, call it VY, where you give another chart domain, and you could exclude, for example, this line, and also map it, the remaining chart domain, map it with y into 0 pi cross 0 2 pi, and the concrete prescription would look somehow similar to the familiar chart. Now these two charts build an atlas, constitute an atlas of S2, and it will be an oriented atlas. This you would in principle have to check as well, but for the sphere it's possible. And now with respect to this atlas, you can define the integral of a whole S2. In order to do so, you have to choose a partition of unity. Well, what is a partition of unity? Partition of unity in this case consists of two functions. One function rho u mapping from S2 into the interval 0, 1, and one function rho v mapping from S2 into the interval 0, 1. And they have to satisfy certain conditions. First, rho u must only take values other than 0 in the chart domain u. So on S2 without u, it has to be as the 0 map. And the same, of course, for rho v. If I exclude v, I have the 0 map. The second condition is that the sum of both functions is 1. That is, at each point I can add those partitions of unity and get 1. And I forgot to say it here, they have to be continuous. So let's put it here as a condition. Rho u and rho v have to be continuous. This is what you had to do in principle. And then you could define this integral as the integral over the chart domain u of the partition of unity function rho u times 1 plus the integral over v of rho v times 1. But I can assure you we won't do this, because we have to construct first such a partition of unity, and I don't know how that looks like. In order to do a quick calculation, we can say, okay, this is a line, and you know, if you integrate over such a line, you will always get 0. And this carries over to lines on a manifold. So in principle, we can only, so it's true, we can only integrate over domains u like this, but we will get the same result. Okay, let's do it. Now, we know how to integrate with respect to a chart. Here it's the familiar spherical chart X. So we integrate over the image of the chart domain under the chart map, which in our case is the product of the interval 0 pi and the interval 0 2 pi. Then we need the volume form. Now, here when it says here the volume of the round sphere with radius r, we understand that we in fact have a metric manifold with our metric components in the familiar spherical coordinate chart x. Are just given by r squared 0 0 r squared sine theta squared a b. And from this metric we may construct a volume form just by calculating the determinant of this metric and taking the square root of it. So here we write the determinant of GAB in the chart and taking the square root out of it. And our function is just a constant function 1. And we integrate two dimensions and call our variables theta and phi. Now, the determinant of this metric is of course just the product of these diagonal elements. So it's r to the power 4 times sine to the power 2 of theta. Now, the square root here will be r squared times sine of theta. And here we don't have to take the absolute value because the sine of theta for theta lying in this interval is always non-negative. It's always positive as well. So we get the integral 0 pi times 0 2 pi of r squared sine theta, and integrating two dimensions, variables theta and phi. Now, employing theorem of Fubini and putting this factor out, can write this as r squared integral from 0 to 2 pi integral from 0 to pi of sine theta d theta d phi. Now this function here does not depend on phi, so we can just carry out the phi integration and get a factor 2 pi. So we have 2 pi r squared, the integral from 0 to pi of sine theta d theta. Of course, this is the function minus cosine theta, and we have to evaluate at 0 and pi. So we have 2 pi r minus cosine of pi is 1, and minus minus cosine of 0 is also 1. So in the end, we get 4 pi r, but not r, but r squared. Of course, this is the formula for the surface of a sphere with radius r. You already know from from elementary school. This concludes the last exercise sheet of the course on mathematical foundations. See you at the next time, where we start with physics.